And welcome back, everyone. I'm Ed Bott. I'm your host today for the Microsoft Virtual Academy Windows 8.1 Jumpstart. Hope you attended the two sessions earlier today, but if you didn't, we're going to begin a very interesting one today, or this afternoon. This session is about deployment, and I know for a lot of IT pros, deployment is one of those words that sort of causes a chilling feeling in the pit of the stomach. Deployment is, especially upgrades from Windows, have historically been one of those things that are a big project. It's something that you plan for months or years, and you roll out all hands on deck for. The interesting thing about Windows 8 and now Windows 8.1 is that Microsoft has changed the way that Windows works. And so for the first time ever, we're seeing a situation where IT pros are able to look at upgrades as something not to fear, but as something to embrace. And we've got someone who can talk to us about that today. Michael Niehaus has joined us. He's an expert on deployment. He helped me with a lot of the research that I did for introducing Windows 8.1 for IT professionals. Michael, thanks for joining us.
Thanks.
Talk to us about the process of deployment and how it's changed from the old days to now.
Yeah, one of the main things that we wanted to do then for Windows 8 to Windows 8.1 is, well, we're coming out with more frequent releases, so we need to have an easier way of deploying it as well. So for those of you that have installed Windows 8 at home, you've already seen this. You've gone out to the Windows Store, you've installed Windows 8.1 from the store, and that's the consumer experience. But for enterprises, we wanted to provide something that was just as easy, but that you could also control. So we've provided ways that you can use something like Configuration Manager and just use a software distribution tool to push out the new operating system to your existing machine, preserving all of your apps, all your data, all your settings, and just making it so that you just run one simple command, setup.exe, and it takes care of doing the actual OS migration for you. So very easy to go from 8 to 8.1. Now, we'll talk a little bit more about the other scenarios, like if we're coming from XP or if we're coming from Windows 7, because those are still more of your traditional OS deployments. But for 8 to 8.1, yeah, we want to make that as easy as possible to get that so that it's reasonably quick.
And that same philosophy applies from 8.1 to whatever the next release is, whenever the next release is. The idea is from now on, these are upgrades that should be a straightforward process.
Right, and we're already starting to see customers that have gone through this process at large scale. Of course, internally at Microsoft, we've done it.
And they survived.
And they've survived. And I think the internal statistics were something like 97% success rate on the update process to go from 8 to 8.1, which is pretty good overall. And then on that remaining 3%, they could then dig in and investigate, well, what caused the issues? Is it a bad driver? Is it bad firmware on a device? Is it an incompatible application? Did someone pull the power plug in the middle of the update so they couldn't finish? But whatever the situation was, Windows was able to roll back to Windows 8, notify IT that this machine didn't update successfully. They could investigate it and then ask the person to try again later. So even though they only had that 97% success rate, most of the failures were very easily recovered from so that they could then try that same machine again. So we did that internally. We've worked with a bunch of customers that are doing that as well. Some of our early adopters started on the first day that Windows 8.1 was generally available doing these large-scale deployments, to the point where we will already start publishing case studies talking about how that process has been going for them.
Now we're still at the time that we're recording this. This is only weeks from general availability,
so yes,
that's a lot of work in a very short time.
Yep.
Now I know for IT pros historically, the big issue for any kind of upgrade, especially from a whole number like 7 to another whole number like 8, the big issue is compatibility. And historically, what people do is they look, well, okay, our enterprise has 2,500 or 3,000 or 8,000 internal applications, so I guess we have to test them all.
Right.
that has historically been the approach that people take. Should they still take that approach?
Yeah, and historically that's been kind of the safe approach, that if you want to make sure that there is absolutely no failures, then you absolutely must test everything. But it's a fairly expensive process to go through to really identify all the apps that you have in your environment. A typical enterprise could easily have 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 unique applications in their environment, and testing that number just doesn't make sense in most cases, because there are apps that are critical to the business, and yes, you're going to test those. There are apps that are more essential, but if they didn't work for a few days, it's not going to be the end of the world. And then there are a whole bunch of apps that really don't matter that much. If the app doesn't work, well, they find another way to get the job done. So really going through the whole app portfolio and trying to put the apps into those different buckets and then figure out which ones you want to test and which ones you're willing to just kind of sit back and see what the result's going to be is an initial exercise to go through on the app compat testing side. At least when we're coming from, say, Windows 7 or Windows 8 to Windows 8.1, we would expect the compatibility to be really strong.
Right.
The desktop apps really aren't affected much because the desktop hasn't changed that much. So if you have an app that works well on Windows 7, you have a pretty good success rate that it's going to work well on Windows 8.1. For modern apps, so apps running in the modern environment on Windows 8, they should all run on Windows 8.1 as well, as we routinely test all the apps in the store to make sure we don't accidentally break something that would affect compatibility with those existing store apps. So we have a pretty good idea of the success rate for the modern apps as well. So no big issues to worry about for desktop apps, no big issues to worry about for modern apps. That really takes us then to hardware.
Aha.
So you have existing machines today. Those computers are running on Windows 7 logo devices, Windows 8 logo devices, some new Windows 8.1 devices, even some older hardware. So
right.
Some people will run Windows Vista and even Windows XP era devices and want to put Windows 8.1 on them. And that certainly works well. Obviously, anything that's Windows 8 logo compliant will run Windows 8.1, no issue. Anything that's Windows 7 compliant will run Windows 8, no issue. The hardware requirements haven't really changed, with a few exceptions that we should probably talk about. But memory footprint, CPU requirements, disk footprint, all of that's the same. Existing drivers continue to work as well, so we don't have to worry too much about drivers, although you will see that there are some drivers that need updates for Windows 8 and Windows 8.1. But overall, existing hardware should be able to run Windows 8.1 very well. I mentioned that there were some exceptions. The exceptions are specifically around some technologies that came out like around Windows XP, SP2 timeframe, mm-hmm. The NX no execute bit that
right.
was used to ensure that there weren't any buffer overrun security vulnerabilities. That's now required for Windows 8 and Windows 8.1. So if you have really old hardware that doesn't support those CPU instructions for no execute, PAE and SSE2 extensions. If the hardware doesn't support those, then it won't be able to run Windows 8 or 8.1.
And I have received emails from a few people who have devices from the 2007, 2008 era that have, they're generally Pentium 4 processors.
The Pentium 4s and Pentium Ds run into a separate problem. With Windows 8.1, those machines probably ran Windows 8 okay, but with Windows 8.1, there was an additional instruction, CPU instruction that's required, like compare and exchange. I forget what the actual instruction name is, but it's documented on the requirements page for Windows 8.1, and it's required only for 64-bit OSs. It isn't required for the 32-bit version of Windows 8.1.
Yeah.
So if you're going to run into issues, it would be probably a Pentium 4 or a Pentium D.
Right.
Some of those did 64-bit, not a whole lot of them. Most of them were 32-bit processors.
Right.
And then you would have to install a 64-bit version of Windows on top of that and want to run Windows 8.1 64-bit on top of that. But a lot of them couldn't even support more than 4 gig of RAM anyway, so not too many people actually run 64-bit OSs on machines that really can't take that much advantage of it anyway. So it's a fairly small percentage of machines that could run into that, but
it is something to check. I think I got an email from each one of those people, though.
Yeah, it's amazing that people will keep that hardware for that long, because yes, those are some fairly old machines now that I can't imagine running Windows anymore on a Pentium 4 or Pentium D machines. But there are some people still doing it, and they still can. They just need to use a 32-bit OS, not 64.
Okay, so but for the most part, with modern hardware, people should have pretty straightforward experiences with installation and upgrades. Now, the other aspect of hardware is peripherals. So any gotchas in the peripheral side of things?
For the most part, no. It's primarily a driver issue again. As long as you have drivers that work on the new operating system, then you should be okay. But most of the subsystems related to desktop apps, driver services, and that kind of stuff hasn't changed in Windows 8 and Windows 8.1, so most of it should still be okay. I think the biggest exception we saw was the display link adapters. If you had a display link dock where you would connect your machine to the dock to drive multiple external displays off of, say, an Ultrabook like the one I've got here, there are new display link drivers that are required for Windows 8.1. But outside of that, it's just going to be the random driver here and there that could have issues and need an update from the vendor.
As I recall, when I was doing the research for the book and you and I were talking about this, one of the things that we agreed was probably a smart thing to do before somebody does an upgrade is to make sure that they've got the network driver for Windows 8.1. Because as long as you've got that one, you can probably get the driver for just about anything else. But if your if your network driver doesn't work out of the box, you're going to have to go scramble and find another machine somewhere to find it, and then go through maybe a few more hoops than you want.
Yeah, because we have a huge number of drivers on Windows Update. And as long as you can get to the network, we can detect any additional drivers that are needed and just go ahead and download them.
Yeah.
So that works pretty well in most cases.
Okay, so let's talk about the two different deployment processes that you've got here. So in the one case, and I would imagine the IT pro community for the most part is a conservative. You know, enterprises are by nature conservative. They've been watching Windows 8 for a year now, and they've been watching Windows 8.1 for a little less than that. Although it's been out for 4 months in various preview versions, so people have had lots of opportunities to see what it does. But so there's two different deployment scenarios. One is if you're moving from 7 or less to 8.1, and the other, the simpler one, if you're going from 8 to 8.1. Let's start with a very common scenario where someone has Windows 7 deployed throughout an organization, perhaps a few islands of Windows XP, and they want to move wholesale to Windows 8.1. What do they need to know?
So going from, say, 7 or XP to Windows 8.1, you would be using one of our typical deployment tools, something like the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit or System Center Configuration Manager, to go through a process that really hasn't changed that much since Windows Vista. I mean, we've done incremental improvements to the process to make it faster, make it more reliable, make it easier, but the basic process itself hasn't changed. It's still going to be using tools like USMT to capture the user data and settings, rebooting into Windows PE where we can remove the old operating system, using tools like ImageX or DISM to lay the new operating system back down on the machine, rebooting into that OS, automating the initial boot up process, then reinstalling the apps and restoring the user data again. That's the refresh process that most enterprises would go through with those systems.
And the one step that was in there somewhere was creating the image that they want to deploy, which is usually not it's not a stock out of the box image. There's usually some sort of customizations that they want to do.
Most
to that.
Organizations create their own images for a few different reasons. Usually, they want to include their additional apps. They want to customize the Windows settings. They want to pre-install software updates. So, they generally will create their own custom image and then deploy that.
Okay. So, do you have examples of some of those tools that we can look at now?
Yeah, we should probably just quickly look at some demos of what those processes look like. So,
great.
Why don't we start out with the 8 to 8.1 process?
Okay.
If you were looking at a Windows 8 system and you wanted to update it to Windows 8.1 and you were, it's a retail machine, it's something that hasn't been volume activated, you would just go to the Windows Store, and the Windows Store would offer you the Windows 8.1 update for free. You click the install button, it does the rest for you. But for enterprises, they need to deploy it themselves because they really don't want to kick that off through the store, having each machine download 2 gig plus from the store in order to update each machine.
Right, and in fact, if you're running Windows 8 Enterprise Edition, you are not going to be offered that update through the store anyway. Right,
right. The store is just smart enough to know that
it's going
to
say no. It's
we won't even offer the update to any volume activated machine. So Windows 8 Enterprise obviously is always volume activated, but Windows 8 Pro could be VL activated as well via KMS or Mac, and we'll be able to see that, and we won't offer the update to those machines.
Okay.
So for those machines, then we need to use something like Config Manager, and let's bring up the demo machine here and let's take a look at what that would look like from the perspective of an existing Windows 8 client. So I've got a machine here running Windows 8. We can see the start menu as it exists here. No start button. That came with Windows 8.1, but I have a Configuration Manager server running in the background where it has published this Windows 8.1 update as something that a user can go out and initiate. So I can come to this web page then and just click Install, and that will initiate the update process. It'll have Config Manager download the necessary pieces for doing the update and then run the automated command, the setup.exe/auto:upgrade, to initiate that update process. That will run through a series of compatibility checks so that we can make sure there's not any known issues on this that would prevent Windows 8.1 from successfully installing. And after that, it will reboot into Windows PE, clean off the old OS, lay down the new OS, preserving all the apps, data, et cetera, during the process. So it's fairly simple. The process that we'll go through is, the timing depends on the type of machine that you're running it on. If I were to run it on my ThinkPad Carbon X1 SSD Ultrabook, it would probably take about 15 minutes. On a virtual machine, on some older hardware, performance is going to vary. So maybe it takes an hour or two to go through this process. But at the end of the process, Windows 8.1 will be fully installed with all your data, settings, and apps preserved.
And this is, and when you say apps, you don't just mean modern apps. You mean desktop programs as well.
Modern and desktop. So everything should be preserved and should work exactly the way it did before in Windows 8. Now, we can let that process run. Maybe we'll come back and look at it if we have some time at the end of the session, but we also want to look at how that's set up in Configuration Manager. So if I switch over to my Configuration Manager machine, and unlock it, we've just set up a package in Configuration Manager with a command line where we say that we want to install with a command line of setup.exe/auto:upgrade. So that's the only command that's necessary to initiate this. The rest of it is really just the complete set of source files for Windows 8.1 downloaded from the Volume License Service Center where we put all the volume license bits for customers to grab. So we've put that out there. We've then deployed that out to a group of users saying we'll make that available for them to select via the application catalog, and then they can initiate that process through the store themselves. Now, as an IT pro, you could also do this with a push method so that instead of having the users go out and do this themselves, you could push out hundreds or thousands of machines at a time. Config Manager is particularly good at distributing large quantities of bits out to lots of machines using bits and other technologies to stream them down to the local machine and then start the process. So you literally could do an entire organization in an evening.
Right.
Just by having Config Manager do the bulk of the work.
And your users show up for work the next morning, they turn on their computer and...
That's the goal. There could be a few failures that we talked about earlier, but yeah. With those failures, Windows would detect the failure and then roll back to the original Windows 8. So you wouldn't even be able to tell that a failure occurred. So in those push deployments, the user's probably never going to even know that an update was attempted. Maybe they look over at the machine in the next cube over, the next office over, and see that theirs was updated and mine wasn't.
Hey, you've got a start button.
And maybe they call the help desk because of that, but otherwise it's just going to be IT on the back end looking at
right.
the results from the deployment and saying, well, we had these few machines that failed. Let's grab the log files for those and see if we can investigate why they failed.
Okay, now, what tools were you just using there, and specifically which versions of those tools were you just using there?
In this case, this is just using Configuration Manager, software distribution. I was using Config Manager 2012 R2, which is the most recent release that fully supports all the new OSs and all the capabilities, but this would work just as well with 2012 SP1, cumulative update 3, I think is the release that's
required. There's a new update that came out a month or so ago that included support for Windows 8.1, but you'd need to
right.
make sure that your deployment tools are properly updated with the bits that support Windows 8.1 before you try this.
Right. Okay. So that's the update process, which works from 8 to 8.1. If we were going from, say, XP or Windows 7, it's a little different because now we're talking about that refresh process that we went through before.
Right.
And we have a few tools to do that, one of which would be the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit, which has been updated for Windows 8.1 support. MDT 2013 is the new release. You probably can't even tell the difference unless you go in and say about Microsoft Deployment Workbench, where it will show version 6.2, or if you went to the home page, it will say MDT 2013. So that is the required release for Windows 8.1 support. It needs to be able to use the latest ADK for Windows 8.1, which is why the new release came out. But there's not a whole lot of changes other than adding support for Windows 8.1 and a variety of bug fixes. So very easy to update your existing MDT 2012, update one infrastructure to MDT 2013 so that you can then do a deployment.
And you could still continue if you're still maintaining older versions of Windows in some places, you could still use the new tools to deploy your existing images.
For most cases, yes. So MDT 2013 will support deploying Windows 7 and above. It won't support XP and Vista anymore. So if you're still deploying Windows XP and Vista, you may want to keep MDT 2012 Update 1 on one machine to do your XP and Vista deployments and then set up a separate MDT 2013 machine to deploy yeah. Windows 7, 8, and 8.1.
This is actually probably a good time to mention that Windows XP is going to reach its end of support date in, is it April 8th? April 8th, 2014. Write that date down. If you have Windows XP machines in your organization, you want to have a plan for moving them to something different, Windows 7 or directly to Windows 8.1.
Right.
Assuming the hardware will support it. Okay.
So why don't we look at a couple of scenarios here. So we've got MDT set up here. We've got some task sequences that we created to deploy Windows 8.1 Enterprise. We can also deploy Windows Embedded Industry 8.1 Enterprise. We don't really have time to talk about that one today, but maybe some point in the future. So we've got those task sequences. They don't really look any different than previous task sequences did. But if we go over to a Windows 7 machine, we can initiate a refresh just by running the standard MDT script.
You've done this before.
just a few times. At least now I do actually spend more time in the new OSs, as it used to be where people would ask me, well, you've been using this operating system for a while, what do you think of it? Well, I deploy it, and then I go back to the old version, and then I deploy it again, so I didn't really use it that much, but now I actually get to spend some time in it. So we'll go through the wizard. We can select the Windows 8.1 Enterprise Task Sequence. Just put it in a work group at the moment. Save myself some typing. Capture the data. We won't create a backup. We'll just specify some basic details needed to drive the deployment process. And then off we go. So it's the same look and feel that you would have had with previous versions. When you deployed Windows 7, you would have went through the exact same process to go from, say, XP to Windows 7. So it won't really be a big difference or a big change for anyone. Now, we mentioned before that MDT 2013 doesn't support deploying Windows XP. It also doesn't natively include any support for migrating from XP to Windows 8.1.
Now that's interesting to me, because with Windows 8, USMT did have that support, right?
Right. The version of USMT included in the ADK for Windows 8 supported XP and above for the source and target OS. For the source, it was XP and above. For the target, it was 7 and above. Right. For the USMT and the ADK for Windows 8.1, it only supports capturing state from 7 and above and restoring to 7 and above. So as a result, you can't use the new USMT to capture user state from XP. So that makes it sound like you can't migrate from XP to Windows 8.1, but you actually can. It just requires using the old version of USMT to capture the user state and the new version to restore it. So we've documented the process of doing that with Configuration Manager 2012 R2 or SP1. There's a blog posting from the Config Manager team that talks about how to do that. For MDT, though, we'll have to make a few script changes. So we'll publish something that describes what those script changes are. But we just had to tweak the USMT script a little bit to say, if you're on XP, run this version. If you're on Windows 7 or above, run this version so that the whole process continues to work. But that gets us really to the same state.
The other option that people have is to move... is to do a two-step migration. They could go from XP to either 7 or 8 and then to 8.1.
You could, but if it's taken you how many years to get from you're still on XP, how long is it going to take you to get from 7 to 8.1? Are we going to be having the Windows 7 end of support conversation a few more years down the line?
So 2020.
Hopefully they'll at least consider going straight to 8.1, but going to Windows 7 is certainly better than XP. So if we have a Windows XP machine, like I've got here, we can initiate that exact same process. Running the same lighttouch.vbs script to initiate it. This is on a Windows XP system, so I've actually got the script on my MDT deployment share that understands that, oh, you're on XP, you need to run the old USMT. So that's what we'll be working on releasing via the blog. So we can initiate that process, but it's really going to look exactly the same as the process that we went through on Windows 7. We'll walk through the same wizard, choose the same task sequence, choose the same options, and initiate.
We're not actually seeing that right now, but as you said, it's a very similar process. You kick off the command, and then presumably you walk away and let it do its magic.
Yep. Yeah, my Hyper-V server back in the office is a little busy right now because it's still updating one machine from 8 to 8.1. It's refreshing Windows 7 to Windows 8.1, and now we're asking it to do XP to 8.1 as well. So it slows down a little bit, but it will shortly kick off the wizard, and we could walk through that same process.
Okay. So you've just done all of the, you've got the tools, everything that's required to update your entire organization straight to 8.1. And at this point, there's really no reason for anyone to go through Windows 8, right? I mean, there's...
No, and from a lifecycle perspective, the count is on for Windows 8 now. It'll be supported for 2 years.
It's two years from GA.
Yeah, it takes the place of Windows 8 in the life cycle. So for those that are not yet deployed on, or not yet deploying Windows 8, but we're looking at it, yeah, most of them will just switch over and deploy Windows 8.1 instead. For those that have already deployed Windows 8, using the update process to get you to Windows 8.1 is the quick and easy way to do that migration.
Okay. So, you know, one of the other things that you talked about, I think that we talked about when I was researching the book, you talked about deploying apps as well. So you can use these same tools to push modern apps out to desktops. How does that work?
That's another topic where we could probably spend an hour talking just about apps, but the 3-minute version basically is that you can push out apps to machines, which is a process called provisioning.
Okay.
When you provision an app on a machine, it then automatically installs for every user on that machine. So when would you want to provision an app? Primarily when you're going to put an app into your image. So as a result, MDT supports provisioning apps. You just add the app into your MDT deployment chair, and then specify the name of the appx file, which is the package containing all the app files. Specify that as the command line. MDT will see that, oh, it's an appx file. I'll build the necessary DISM command line to provision that app on the machine so it then automatically installs at deploy time. So provisioning per machine with MDT. For other scenarios, though, Configuration Manager supports the installation of an app for a particular user. Installation is always done per user. So in order to use an app, it has to be installed for every user on the machine that wants to use it.
Got it.
Not just install it once and then any user can use it. It actually gets installed for every single user on the device. So if you've got 4 users, you're going to install that app 4 different times. So Config Manager fully supports installing appx files. It knows how to do that. It then allows you to target groups of users or individual users so that you can push that out. It includes an app catalog, which is a website where users can go and select apps. And now with Config Manager 2012 R2, they've also provided a company portal app. That company portal app lets you then select from the apps that are available internally, not just the apps that are in the Windows Store. So it's kind of like your own internal enterprise app store. You use that instead of the public app store for the apps that are specific to your business.
And I think we're going to talk about the company portal later in the day.
Yes, I'm sure Martin will show that as part of his demos later.
Yeah, so we've got that there. So now the last part of the equation, once you've got this deployed out there, is, you know, people are used to deploying updates in a variety of ways to their users. Well, one of the things about modern apps is that they are, at least by default on consumer and retail machines, now set with Windows 8.1 to update silently, automatically in the background, right?
Right.
What's the enterprise version of that story? Has that changed?
Well, if you have apps that come from the Windows Store, it really doesn't matter if it's enterprise or retail. I mean, in either scenario, they're going to be updated from the store automatically in the background with no user interaction. It just happens, which is great for not only the apps from the Windows Store, but also the inbox apps. The inbox apps will get updated the same way. So mail and Bing search and news and all of those other built-in apps will get updated automatically. For other apps that you've deployed internally via this application catalog or company portal, you would just push out a new version to machines that have the existing one.
Right.
The platform basically knows that, oh, there was an older version of this app installed. You're now pushing out a new version. I'll just replace that version with this version and maintain all the app data that went along with it.
And the behavior for the line of business apps is the same as the store apps. In that general sense, right?
Right. The main difference for the line of business apps being pushed out through Config Manager is that the machine has to be enabled for sideloading. So there are some specific sideloading requirements around, well, first you have to either be running enterprise or have a sideload key installed. You have to set a policy that says you'll allow sideloaded apps to be installed. And whatever certificates were used to sign those apps need to be trusted by Windows so that they can verify that this app hasn't been tampered with. But once you've met those requirements, then you can deploy any app you want internally as long as you've got the AppX files to install them.
Great. Now, when we were talking about this a month or two ago, I remember you said there's a lot of new changes in group policy that have come with Windows 8.1. Can you give some general advice to people on areas that they can look at that they might want to consider as part of their deployment process?
For group policies, I think Ben talked about the start screen ones this morning. Basically,
yes.
You can create a start screen layout as an XML file and then set a start screen control policy that mandates that layout for a user, and they can't change it, they can't touch it. So that's one. All of the boot to desktop and start screen, all apps, all of those are exposed as policies as well. There's new smart search capabilities in Windows where you just start typing on the start screen and it searches your local drive and your apps and then searches Bing and images and all kinds of other stuff. There are a variety of group policies associated with that. Some organizations don't want that, so there are policies to turn that off.
So if you don't want to see, and I can imagine that it might expose some company knowledge, company information, if you have search requests that are going out to a search service like Bing, people might want to say, nope, well, we can disable that, and that could be done as part of the deployment process and through group policy at any time.
Right. Yeah, and one of the policies is specifically around what information is sent to Bing as part of those search requests. So you can control what level of information is provided. If you don't want to do it at all, then there's a separate policy that just says turn off smart search so that you only search the local drive then as part of that search experience on the start screen.
Right.
So there are policies like that. Basically, any new features that we've added the group policies to go along with those. I don't think we've run into any exceptions to that yet. So we've been pretty good about trying to provide the policies for the new features as we add them in. So for the most part, we did publish last week a spreadsheet that has all of the group policies for Windows 8.1 in it. So users might want to download that, look through it and see if they can identify the policies that have been added. One thing that we did notice, though, is that there were a few mistakes in the policy definitions themselves that didn't clearly indicate that it was a new policy in Windows 8.1,
okay,
like those smart search policies. So if you filter the list by policies that are only applicable to Windows 8.1, you might miss a few. So we'll get that fixed when we get a chance. It's actually a problem in the operating system. If you look in the group policy editor, they're not tagged appropriately. So when the spreadsheet was built from that data, it didn't show that either. So we'll get that cleaned up. But in the meantime, don't assume that just because you can't find it doesn't mean it isn't there. It's just probably showing up as a general policy that applies to all versions of Windows instead of just 8.1.
Well, and so many documents like that are living documents. Don't assume that because you read it last week that it hasn't been updated this week.
Yeah, we also had quite a few questions from the chat this morning asking about the ADMX files for those group policies. They want to update either their central policy store or their server to have the latest Windows 8.1 policy templates. And we haven't yet published that for download. That hopefully will be coming soon. In the meantime, the policy definitions are in the Windows folder. Not surprisingly, in the policy definitions folder under Windows, or you can just take those and copy those to your server to be able to use them until we've released the downloadable version.
Great. So we've talked about a bunch of tools here. This is for people who've been doing Windows deployment for several generations of Windows now, this should be familiar stuff. But there are, you know, people who are new to the process. Where can they go to both find these tools and find the detailed information on how to use them and so forth?
We've tried to provide as much information as we could through the Springboard site, so that would be the first place to go.
Okay.
I'm sure we've mentioned the Springboard URL so many times already, but...
We haven't done it enough times today, so feel free.
You're going to ask me to recite the memorized Springboard. If you go to where?
technet.com/windows.
All right, that works. I think there are probably six or seven different URLs that actually get you to the same place.
And if that doesn't work, you just go to Bing and search for Springboard.
It'll find it.
And you'll get there. And you'll find all those tools.
Yeah, so that's where we try to put all the information on the tools, the kind of the scenario walkthroughs, the step-by-step guides, really trying to provide enough to teach you how to use these tools. There'll be a lot of links then into the product documentation to get into more details, but that's the starting point.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much. This has been a great conversation. I think anybody who's interested in more information about deployment knows where to go. The Springboard site is going to help you out. We're going to take a short break now, and when we come back, Michael will be joining us again. And we'll be talking about some interesting new technologies for mobile devices. And we'll also be joined by another guest who will be talking about a technology called Windows to Go, which lets you put Windows on a USB stick and run it from anywhere. So come back after the break.